Welcome to Tour's Castle Video Tour. I'm your narrator and presenter, Sid Lincoln. This section of the tour will be narrated in the French language. Le chapelle date depuis le XIVe siècle. Un renaquement de le XIVe siècle. La chapelle était même trop grande pour la résidence de l'archevêque. Dans le XXe siècle, reconstitution. Dans les fouilles archéologiques menées en 1971, de nombreux morceaux de carreaux de sol médiévaux décorés ont été récupérés. De nouveaux carreaux reprenant le motif des anciennes ont été conçus par le sol de la chapelle lors de sa restauration dans les années 2000. Est-ce qu'il y a quelqu'un qui veut jouer le jeu au trône? Dans le XXe siècle, reconstitution. Ce haut corps de Menet, fouille, une pièce d'argent française a été trouvée dans les fondations. Elle date au début du XIVe siècle. Comme vous pouvez le voir, la chapelle a été entièrement restaurée. Un nouveau toit a été ajouté. Les murs étaient complets et crenelés. De nouvelles fenêtres ont été commandées en 2008. Ils sont inspirés par le verre taché médiéval à la cathédrale Châtrée en France. Les illustrations décrivent Jésus-Christ, Mère Marie. Les quatre évangélistes, Matthieu, Marc, Luc et Jean. Et aussi le signe de Zodiac. Les chandeliers sont des copies du XIIIe siècle, medieval style. On fait par main. Une nouvelle galerie en bois a été également ajoutée. Et si vous regardiez, la galerie de bois ont les poutres de bois, les murs. Il y a une série de têtes sculptées. Elles sont basées sur les personnes travaillant sur les sites à l'époque et comprenant les visages de Contrenet et de l'architecte. Le chapelle a été utilisé par de nombreux événements, notamment des mariages civils, des expositions. Les chansons de Noël. Des concerts. Country round my shoulders, it's flag raised on a gallows tree. I won't. The remainder of the tour will be narrated in the English language. I know. The chamber block contains three floors of accommodation. This plan arrangement is very typical of the 13th and 14th centuries and is found in virtually all manorial residences of the time. At ground floor level is the undercroft. This was used as a storage area and still used for the same purpose today. Who turned off the light? A small external steel stairs provides access to the first floor chamber. This stairs was added in 2019 and replaced a wooden one which was previously replaced, a much older wooden structure. The first floor was probably used as a waiting area for visitors. A short spiral staircase leads up to the Archbishop's private chamber or solar, where he slept and entertained guests. The chamber block has also been largely reconstructed since 1995. The new work included stylish stone surrounds to the window opening, medieval wooden doors, walls extended upwards to incorporate new crenellated features. Two limestone fireplaces, including one with a medieval style grate. The chamber block is linked to the chapel via a small stairway which leads to a doorway to the balcony, which gives a beautiful view of the chapel below. The external door originally opened onto an exterior balcony access walkway, which was probably over the original porch. The walkway would have run along the wall of the chapel to the Archbishop's apartments building on the eastern range. Consists of parts of earlier buildings which are no longer standing. It's the oldest part of the complex, dating back to the 12th century. It contains the Archbishop's apartments, the East Tower, the Gable, and the North Tower. Apartments dates back to the early 14th century and was originally a two-story building. This is where the various archbishops lived while they were resident in Swords Castle. In its prime, this was a building of considerable grandeur. It contained a reception room, a bedchamber,
we thank God in his mercy,
and a private oratory. During the 71 archaeological excavations, a decorated medieval tile pavement was uncovered at the floor level of the building. The tile patterns included a lion's head and floral designs. These illustrations were popular in the 14th and 15th century, and for a builder to have these type of tiles is a clear indication of the wealth of the archbishops during this period. What remains of the East Tower is immediately north of the Archbishop apartments. It originally extended upwards to three floors. On the first floor, a large arch-headed doorway connects to the Archbishop's apartments. The building is thought to have contained a chamber for friars. In 2019, Swords Castle won the Heritage and Conservation Award for the inventive work on the East Tower consolidation, which was carried out by the Architects Department in Fingal County Council and various consultant entities. An arch Gothic arch window dominates an area known as the gable. It has the look of an enchanting and romantic room, which makes it a perfect place for those wedding photos. This wall is the outside of the building. On the other side of that picturesque window would have been the Great Hall stretching out towards North Street. And the Archbishop would have hosted banquets for their local gentry. Sumptuous feasts consisting of roasted pig, beef and vegetable soup, fried fish, freshly baked white bread with bowls of whipped butter were being all consumed and all washed down with wine imported from the south of France. The Archbishop and his friends dressed in their very best clothing for the occasion. Medieval musicians provided the entertainment and the banquet could go on until well into the night. I can almost smell the gravy. Just beyond the gable is a wall, which was once part of the building connecting to the now ruinous remains of the North Mural Tower. The only section still visible on the internal face is part of a stone vault. A mural tower is a fortified structure that provided flanking fire against the enemies of the castle. The Constable's Tower stands tall and proud against the backdrop of the Sorderonian sky. This pretty building dates back to the 14th century. The constable was the person in charge of the castle and when Archbishop was not in residence. They had their own courts of justice, where they were allowed to try such crimes as murder, theft and not paying taxes.
How do you plead? Guilty.
The Constable's Tower was fully restored between 1996 and 1998. New features include medieval wooden doors. Tudor style windows. Crenellations to the upper walls. An apex roof with two statues of lions. And all topped off with a cute little belfry tower. The ground floor and the east spiral staircase are not accessible to the public. The rest of the building is accessed by the long, narrow spiral staircase on the west side, which leads to the first floor room and then continues onto the second floor room. Some notable features of these rooms are a lovely limestone fireplace. Timber beam floors. A most unusual chandelier featuring six carved animal heads made entirely of oak. Tourists will also find a medieval toilet. During the time, Archbishop Cowan was a resident in Sword Castle. Richard I was a reigning king of England. He was known as Richard the Lionheart, and it was he who designed the Three Lions coat of arms, which can be found on the north-facing window on the first floor room of the Constable's Tower. From the 12th and 14th century, the curtain walls surrounding the castle enclosure on the north, south and west side were originally lower in height than they are now. It wasn't until the mid 15th century that the curtain walls were extended upwards to incorporate new crenellated features and four mural towers were added for defence purposes. These towers consisted of the previously mentioned Constable's Tower, the rooms of the North Tower, West Tower and the Southwest Tower. Three battlement wall walks were also originally added to the northwest and south walls. Two of the wall walks were initially reconstructed in the 1990s, using wood, and again in 2019 using steel. Swords Castle was never very strong in military sense. The lack of height would have rendered the bowmen on the walls vulnerable to attack from invading armies. This proved to be true in the year 1642, when the castle was used as a meeting point for the Irish Catholic Confederation forces, who rebelled against the British Parliamentary forces. Sir Charles Coote was commissioned to raise a regiment by the British Parliamentary government. He marched to Fingal and attacked Swords Castle, where he defeated the rebels, killing 200 of them. Was originally a three-story structure dating back to the early 13th century. Sadly, it is now in ruins. A historical account from the year 1326 gives a fascinating description of the knights and squires in its original form. There are four chambers for knights and squires, roofed with shingles. Under these, a stable and bakehouse. There was a house for a dairy and carpenter's workshop. Anglo-Norman archbishops were not only men of the church, but also military men. So it stands to reason that they would have knights employed on their property for military and security reasons. In the 15th century, the building was altered from three-story to two stories. Polygonal turret lookout tower is from the 15th century. You there, yes you, come down. And in one corner, a large 16th century brick-lined oven can still be seen. The circular stairs to the north was altered to form a straight stairs from ground to first floor level, possibly during the period when the Dutch Protestant group of refugees were settled in Swords Castle in the late 16th century. In 2001, an archaeological excavation was carried out in front of and to the west of the Knights and the Squires building. Evidence of wall footings, paths and a rough stony ground surface were amongst the findings. It is thought this area may have been used as a yard. So taking into consideration, this area and the area directly in front may have been the location of the fair, the yearly fair, which is established by the Archbishop Cowan on the 9th of June, the feast day of St. Columba. The fair took place over a 7-day period. Buyers and sellers would gather from near and far. All kinds of goods were being sold, from coats of armour to salted fish to fresh meat. Fast food was available for snacking, and musicians provided the entertainment. The gatehouse originated in the early 13th century. And it was during this time period that the constable William Garrott was said to have been murdered at the gate of the Court of Swords. The gatehouse we see today dates back to the 15th century. It contains a first floor chamber accessed by spiral staircase inside the Knights and Squires building. In 2014, the collapsed arch of the gatehouse was rebuilt and a new protective roof installed. And while this work was being carried out to stabilise the roof and the wall, 17 burials were unearthed dating back to the 12th century. In many early documented sources, the enclosed area of ground within the walls of Swords Castle has been variously described as a barn, courtyard, a haggard, a garden, and an orchard. From the 12th to the 16th centuries, the grounds were predominantly used to store grain and crops, and probably livestock for short periods as needed. It wasn't until the 18th century when it was first described as having a garden and an orchard. A historical Ordnance survey map from that time period indicates a Georgian cultivated garden was within the enclosure of the castle. Flowers, herbs, vegetables and bush fruits were planted there. Later in the 18th century, during the Victorian era, the enclosure was documented as having an orchard containing apple trees and plum trees. The few surviving apple trees growing at present on the east side of the enclosure date from the 19th to the early 20th century and are the remains of the orchard planted by the Cole family, who purchased the castle and the grounds in 1830.
What do you think of your new purchase, sir?
The oldest surviving tree is this Bramley apple tree dating back to the 1890s. Today, in the 21st century, the grounds within the castle enclosure resemble a park with picnic tables dotted all over the complex, making it the perfect place for visitors and of all the types to come and have a bite to eat. It was used as a filming location
for Tudors 2010. And for the Vikings 2018.
Our scouts tell us that the Viking army is encamped about here. They may wish to increase the size of their already considerable force.
And there was a short film called The Legend of Cambria.
Looking out across a field of men who'd once tried to end me, I buried bitterness with my disfigured past.
During National Heritage Week in 2015, 2016 and 2017, an archaeological digging took place in the grounds of the castle. Members of the public were invited to help with the digging, washing and bagging historical artefacts. The castle place hosted public events throughout the year, such as a summer festival, the Fla, Fingal Festival of Fire for Halloween, and the Christmas Market. So as Castle opened its big black iron gate to the public in the summer of 2015. And since then, the National Monument has constantly been enjoyed by locals and international visitors alike.